Welcome to the Langridge. Lovely walk with this. We've just been over North Met Pit. The plan was to fish there, make a video on there, but I've just walked around for a couple of hours. Proper pouring of rain, torrential, got soaked, t-shirt soaking, hair soaking as you can see. But yeah, it's like pea green soup, there's an algae. I couldn't find nothing, and on a place like that, it's pretty low stock, so I want to be fishing where the fish are. And when you can't find them, I feel like I'm losing that. And we're over the Langy now. I was going to fish here for the autumn, starting in a couple of weeks' time, but I thought I might as well come in now, put the bait in, see what the spots are like, prep it ready for a couple of weeks' time. And yeah, it's a really wild pit. You'll see as we get round, but I'm going to load the barra, get it sorted. It's an absolute mission. What a mission that is. We're at the final furlong now, back at the Ellis Palace. See what it looks like. Right, that's my last bag. I've rushed and set the bivvy up. Everything's thrown in now, I've got to sort that out. We've had a lot of rain today and it's raining now. I can see it coming over the lake, so it's gonna be a wet one. This plaque here, I had this made last year. Fish called the Langridge Common. Lovely carp, that one. But I'll speak to you more about that later. But I wanna get the rods out, get new rigs on. And I want to see if the spots were as clean as they were when I left them last autumn. Let's check it out. Good to be back. I've got two rods back on the spots that I fished last autumn and they're still clean, getting good drops. Hopefully the fish are there. I'm a bit earlier than last year, but I'm quite confident it's looking good out there. After that trip round North Met earlier in the pouring rain and that treacherous journey through all the jungle to get here, it's pretty overgrown. I've not been here since early spring this year, so the weeds grown since, oh, the nettles and that, I'm stunk to bits, but that's my style of fishing. I thrive on this big pit wild fishing and I love it. So I'm going to get some bait out. I'm not going to get some bait out until it's dark because there's a lot of coots on here. And I'm so used to getting my rods out after work on a Friday. Last person there, it's getting dark, especially in the autumn. So I'm normally casting out in the dark as well. And I will be here on a Friday normally. And I think that's a bit of an edge to be fair, especially on the busy water. In here it don't really matter. But I'm putting whole boilies out, 15mm cell with tigers with multi-stim. I use the tigers a bit harder, and if the birds pick them up, they can drop them easier, they stay on the spot. The cell is pretty soft, like, especially when it's been in the water. The crayfish love them, crunch them up. The more bait on the spot, the better, because I use crayfish to my favour. I want as much bait on the spot, I tend to overbait, and I'm literally, I want my spot wriggling, because the carp like the crays in here, they eat them. Same as North Met Pit, I learnt that. When I had baby Basil, it was passing crushed crayfish, so I use them as my little friends, to be fair. So I want my spot wriggling. So I use 15mm cell, highly digestible to the carp. You can't even overfeed the carp. They love it. It's a bait I take everywhere. Tiger nuts, I normally put them in the mix if there's crayfish or not. If the lakes don't allow, I just use straight boilie. So yeah, it's looking good. It's good to be back. I'm gonna get the old aero press out now. And yeah, chill out, watch the world go by. It's good to be back in the palace, the old Ellis Palace. Good times. So, we'll see what happens tonight.
Cheers.
Right, the rods are back out, the sun's burnt the mist off, and it's looking like a good morning, late morning, should we say, going into the afternoon. We've got a crosswind, it's dragging me lines and stuff with weeds, so I'm going to have to recast again. But for now, I'm going to take you through the rig. This is my go-to rig everywhere, but it all started fishing crayfish waters like North Met down the road. A stiff boom, 40 pound outline fluoro. Now that has got resetting properties. A pop-up on this Ronnie is deadly when it comes to crayfish. They can play about with it, even the birds can pick it up, and it always resets. But the main thing is to tie your hook bait on with braid. Now, I've done it myself. I tied my hook baits on over North Met Pit, first trip, all with floss, three rods with floss, three rubber hook baits, reeled in the next morning, no baits on any of them. And I met a mate over there and he went, "No, you got to tie my braid." Since then, this rig, it might look a bit of an eyesore, the top end, you've got to blob it all with the braid and stuff, but I'd much rather have a hook bait out there looking a bit like an eyesore than no hook bait. Now, if you can get your head around crayfish, I like to use crayfish as my friends. I'll put a load of bait in, I literally overbait to get as many crayfish on my spot as possible, because when they carp move in, the crayfish disappear and it leaves your hook bait sitting nice. If I weren't using this Ronnie with this setup and braid tight on, I wouldn't have a bait there when the carp moved in. So that's a massive edge. If you're not doing it, I suggest you do it. Like I said at the beginning of the video, I'm going to take a bit of time out to talk to you about that common, that special capture that's on my plaque, and a few other fish, and also the reason why I decided to come to the Langridge. Basically, after Burfield, I was struggling to find somewhere and get settled with my own peace and quiet. I just wanted to go somewhere out of the way, no spawns down in my water, wake up in the morning, not see another bivvy, and just chill. And this place, I didn't really know much about it, and looking on the internet and stuff, all I could find on old forums and stuff was, oh, there's about 30 carp, it's rock hard, and I thought, I'll do it. I managed to get a ticket, Andy Loretta let me on, and Barbara, so big thanks to them. And I got myself a ticket, and it's just a paradise. It's a quiet bank, really hard to get on, and it's literally untouched, it's wild. I cut my own swim out, as you know, and basically, I come on here with the mindset of, there's 30 carp, 180 acres, I'm here for the autumn. If I catch, bonus. If I don't catch, I don't care, I just want to chill. I spoke to a few people about the place and they're like, what are you doing there? There's nothing in there. So it was like, I'm going into the autumn thinking I'm going to blank, and it turned out to be something phenomenal. So my first session, I cut the swim out like you saw, and basically didn't really expect much. I thought I'd have to do a big baiting campaign to get the fish to me, bring them to me. I've only got one area to work with. So the second night, I caught my first carp, 27 pound common, which was nice. And then I come back the Wednesday, I went home on the Sunday and fish weekends, come out on the Wednesday, baited, and then come back the following Friday. And that weekend was an absolute red letter. I managed 13 fish and lost one, unfortunately. But that common was in one of them 13 fish, 32 pound. And it was like, I've seen a picture of it before, and it was just mega. It's like the Burfield common, but a smaller miniature version. So I thought, I call that the Langridge common. There's four separate angling clubs on here, like I said, and these fish have probably all got names, but I come on here doing my own thing, so I named it myself. So basically, that was like probably my fourth fish, and it was like, wow, like that's one I really wanted. I don't know what's in here. I don't care what's in here. I just want to catch carp, if I can even catch anymore. So yeah, I managed three different 39 pounders, but there's a sluice from coming in here from a relief channel that comes from Nays in Meads. And when I was in there, if you watch my Madness on the Meads video, My mate had a fish out of there, 38 pound linear, and it's quite a nice dumpy fish. And I thought, and I see a picture of it from here, right, and I thought, maybe. I didn't really believe that they'd come down the sluice. It's a mile, like come down the relief channel. It's a mile long. They have to go over a massive overflow from Nazy and down the relief channel through a sluice gate into here. And I didn't really believe it. But then my second carp I caught was actually that 38 pounder my mate caught 2 years back in the winter when I fished Nazy. And I was like, well, if there's 30 fish in here, there's a lot more now, maybe. So it gave me a bit of like a bit of a boost with confidence. And it turns out later on, a few months later, I got speaking to a few people that fished the other banks. And they said to me, yeah, there's more than 30 fish, you're looking at about 50 to 60 fish. So I was like, oh, right. That's still low stock, isn't it? For the size of the water, that is still a mega low stock water. And it's mad because I was seeing photos of fish, people were showing me pictures, and every single picture I saw of a fish, I'd catch. Like, it was mental. So it's telling me it's low stocked, you know what I mean? So I was having a good time, and yeah, that 30 pound common, that was a really good one. I had a 39 pound, one of the 39 pounders was a mirror, and it's got like a big sloping, like weird shaped head. And I've been told that was last caught 6 years ago. Not too sure because other people can catch it and keep it quiet, but the last known capture was 6 years ago. And that was, that's probably a good 40 now. Because I caught them early on, they were still building up from spawning, getting their weights back on. And there was also another one. It was a 32 pounder. I think it's an old original. There's not many originals left in here, but this was a proper old original, yellow eyes or something. And it absolutely tore. I've got footage of that playing it. And it just kited right, didn't get no line on it, kited right, and then just took line and took line and took line right out into the middle of the pond. Managed to get it back. And yeah, that was another 32 pound mirror. Mega carp, but so powerful. It was like being attached to the Burfield Common again. And this place, it was like, wow, like this is, I'm here on my own. It was like paradise, and it still is now. I've been away all year, done a bit in the spring, but I'm back now. I'm hoping to repeat what happened last year. And there's some really cool carp. One that stands out for me, although that mirror, the original, was a really nice one. One that stands out for me is a 37 pound mirror, and that was also from Nazing. Got caught out there in 2001. It escaped over the overflow, down the relief channel, ended up in here. And apparently one geezer has caught it since 2001. Up until now, he's caught it twice, the same person had it twice, and I've caught it again. So it's been caught three times by two different people since 2001 out of here. So when fish get in here, they get lost, you know what I mean? And there's plenty of others in here like that. There's another one. After that 13 fish hit I had, there was a geezer messaging me on Facebook, and he said, oh, my mate's had a fish out there called Paw Print. I was like, oh, right. I was like, you got a picture? He went, no, I've got no picture like that. And after that 13 fish hit, I was on my way to work, it was like the Monday, and I see this massive full moon, and I was like, I caught all them fish, and it was the build up to the full moon. I thought, I've got to be there tonight. As soon as I got to site in London, phoned up the boss, I was like, look, it's gonna sound a bit strange, but I had 13 fish from a really difficult lake the weekend. Some lakes, they like to respond to moon phases, and this one's definitely one of them. So before I could even go any further, he's like, so basically, you wanna make the most of that prime time. I went, yeah, that's the one. He's not a carp angler. I was like, yeah, that's the one. And he let me have the day off. So after work, come back down here, and I managed two. I managed a 29 pound linear, and I caught this 35 pound mirror. One side, big light, you could call it toast rack. Big scales down his flank, near his, not on the wrist of his tail. And the other side, the classic paw print, yeah? And I was like, that's gotta be it. Sent the photo to this geezer. He went, yeah, that's paw print. His mate had it at 38, I had it at 35, so that bit down anyway after spawning like the others. And yeah, I was like, mate, this place is low stock. Everything I'm hearing about, every fish picture I'm seeing, I'm catching them. So there's other fish in here. I had three repeats. I had 26 carp, three of those were repeats, and one of those repeats was a 39, and I managed to have that at 40 pound 8 ounce. So I managed 140, but there is other 40s in here and some other bigger ones. So I'm here this autumn to hopefully get one of those bigger ones. And it's going to be exciting times. No doubt I will catch a few more repeats, but it's like a mystery. I don't know anywhere in the country now where you can fish and don't know what you're going to catch in an environment like this, what I'm sitting in now. It's just absolute paradise, away from everything. The fish act normal, they're all natural. They literally get in the edges. They do things textbook style. For instance, I was on the phone with my mate and I see a fish over my spot when I'd done 13 fish. And I was on the phone, I was like, just seen a fish show, look like up to 20, low 30. Anyway, rod's gone, put the phone down, 29 pound mirror. So you're seeing fish over catching them. That is pretty unheard of these days on these busy waters. This is like going back in time, and it's the ultimate. Absolutely love it. So now I'm back on here for this autumn. I found out a few fish that got caught late autumn last year, and to be fair, if I didn't find out about those carp, I would have been done. I thought I would have had them all. After three repeats, all them fish, all the photos I'm seeing, I would have thought that I was pretty much done, but there's a fish in here that did get caught, and I didn't have a drive before I come here. I just come here to chill and see what I could catch. Didn't care if I caught or not. I just wanted to be on my own, cut my own swim out, and be in paradise. But now I've got a drive. I've seen what this is, and I'm not going to say too much, but when I've got a drive and a passion for a carp, nothing stops me, and I go hard, really hard. And if I'm putting my mind to it, I think I could have it this autumn. So fingers crossed, we'll see how it goes. You could be seeing me again, do something rather special. Now going into the second night, I'm feeling a lot more confident tonight. I've seen a fish show, quite long, but they're in the area. On a big pit like this, even if they're 100 yards behind me, last year I was seeing them show and they was coming to me. So anywhere in that area, I'm confident. Also, there was a big storm earlier, torrential rain for a few hours, and I had a drop back. It didn't register on my receiver. There's a lot of weed between me and the spot, and basically it's kited and dropped back slightly. So I've got out, picked it up, and there's a few bream in here, a few tench, but the amount of line it's taken, kite and round, is telling me it's a carp. The more I think about it, the more it's a carp. So I'm getting to my second night now, overly confident. I'll put a lot more bait out, and hopefully we'll get back to her during the night with a big carp within the net. Occurred last night, but I wasn't really expecting much. I think I heard one about 3 this morning, sharp range, so that's a good sign. I started last year on here at about September, a couple of weekends in September. Now we're in the middle of August. I wanted to start a bit earlier because I thought I could have caught more. So it's the start of the autumn campaign now. I need to put some bait in. The first few sessions might be a bit slow, but I'm hoping I can kick it off a bit earlier and then finish around November time, because after November it really slowed up. So we're gonna try and get a little bit more action in this time around. But the reason I chose this swim, it's got deeper water. I started leading about in a swim next door last year. If you've seen me at this diaries, you would have seen what I was doing. But if you haven't, it's a little recap, keep you up to date. But basically the swim next door, I was leading about. The further right I went, it was getting deeper and deeper. So this swim you can see now, this is the area I wanted to fish from, but there was no, you couldn't even see the water. It was so overgrown and I've had to cut it out, but yeah, I was doing it, and all along when I was doing it, I thought, am I gonna have a spot? Is it gonna be weedy? Is it gonna be shallower? Has it got further out? So I've cut all the swim out before I've even had a lead about. And when I did have a lead about, it was all weed, weed, weed. Further out I went, I got a drop. So the plan was to find a spot, make sure it weren't black seal and my baits weren't going black, and I was going to bait it particle-wise. I was going to just try and... I don't know how many bream and tench were in here. I didn't even know how many carp were in here. So I'm trying to attract the smaller fish. Hopefully the carp will come. But before I could even do that, I caught a carp. So it was straight boilie and tiger nuts from then on. But if I didn't catch that carp, I would have still baited, trying to attract the smaller fish to try and clean the spot. But as luck would have it, and it was luck to be fair, I dropped right on the fish. I had a really good autumn. I didn't have to put all that effort in baiting. I pretty much caught straight away. But this year, I've got to let them know I'm back here, so I've got to bait again, and it will be boilies. The spots are clean still, quite hard still, so I can just put boilies, tigers in. I ain't got to worry about the particle. As it happens, there's not many bream in here. I've caught two, so it's quite low stock on bream, which is handy, and it's mainly carp, big carp. There's a few special ones in here. I don't really know the stock exactly. When I first started, I thought it was going to be... All I could see on the internet was there's 30 carp, blah, 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 but... It turns out there's a few more, roughly 60 to 70 carp, but it's 180 acres, give or take. So that's a big pit, low stock, and I've only got one swim. There's four different angling clubs on this water, so I've got a ticket on one section, and this swim here is the only swim really on my section that gives me deeper water. Now I chose this deeper water just so the bird life stays away from the bait a little bit more, as opposed to fishing in 3 foot. I want the depth because the fish like a bit of deeper water. Fishing other waters, big pits and stuff, I normally find that in the autumn time, they do go out into open water, the deeper areas, and I like to bait from August onwards. That's why I'm here now. I started last year, like I said, in September. So I wanted to bait ready. And if I start catching them now, I can keep it going all the way through until it slows up in the winter. Now, the plan was to fish it all winter last year. I didn't, I pulled off because it proper shut up shop. So this year, I've got a ticket on somewhere else starting from November. So I'm here till... start of November, and hopefully we're going to get a few along the way. So it's going to take a couple of weeks, get the bait on the spot, let them know I'm here, but I'm buzzing to be back. I love it here, it's like a paradise, got my own little paradise. Competition is something that is very rare. Now I get a lot of messages asking me if I do tutorials, and to be fair, I just don't get the time. I work full time and fish, yeah, do my own fishing at weekends. So this opportunity is something to grab. Basically, it's 24 hours fishing with me on a venue that suits you, on a date that suits you, or a venue that I can choose and you can tag along. I get a lot of messages from Instagram, Facebook and stuff. A lot of you asking if I do tutorials, which I don't. So this is your opportunity. If you're struggling on a certain water and you want me to tag along, or even if you just want a social, you can come on a social, pick me brains either way, and we'll have a good time. Basically, all you need to do to enter this is like this video, subscribe to the Avid YouTube channel, click that notification bell. But the main thing as well, you've got to do all these. I mentioned three fish at the start or during this video that I like the most, and that was the Langridge Common at £32, the original mirror, the yellow ab one at £32, and also that £37 rare one. So basically, do all that, like the channel, subscribe, click the bell, and type the Langridge Common, the rare one, and that original mirror. Either one of them in the comments box, whatever one you think's the best, that'll enter you into this competition. And who knows, I could even bring you, if I get permission, for 24 hours in the Ellis Palace, right where we are now. Oh, Welcome to the famous bridge at King's Weir Fishery, overlooking the lovely River Lee. Some massive barbel and chub in here, but it's my halfway point back to the motor. Gives me time to have a little breather, de-sweat a bit, get these nettles out of my arms and stuff, because it's a real rough ride, as you know. But yeah, this is an insight into my real fishing. I'm here now for the rest of the autumn. Hopefully, I can repeat what happened last year. So, I really hope you enjoyed watching this video as much as I've been here making it. Don't forget to enter that competition, and we can get out soon.